So we fixed the audio problems. We will start. Next up is Brian.
Well, what can I say about Brian? He's basically one of the two parts of the hardware brain at ER&W, and he has brought a big zoo of embedded devices that all do some sort of mobile communication. And he will walk us through this zoo and present us the findings that he's made. Brian, stage is yours.
So, hi. Slides. This is the very good thing about actually having Bluetooth slide clickers. They work when they want.
Actually, this is the thing I was talking about when the Bastille guys had their talk. This is why we're having like problems now with presenters, because we needed to change all of them.
It's their fault, because they broke them.
It's their fault. Are they here in the room still? They should feel ashamed now, but they're obviously not here.
Yeah.
Yeah,
ooh.
Showing
all the
security.
Yes.
Got it. So, I think Flo already did the introduction. So, I'm Brian. Whoever knows me, Batch Wizard, doing some of, a lot of hardware stuff here at ER&W. So, what I'm going to talk about today, I'm not really aiming at actually hunting for vulnerabilities at the moment and actually breaking stuff the way that we'd usually do with new embedded devices. For me, right at the moment, it's rather a question of actually understanding how stuff out there works. So we've got more and more devices that use some kind of cellular communication. Let it be something between cars and lamps at your home that you simply want to be able to control from remote by sending a text message. Devices that you can start a voice call with, and as such control them, or simply devices that use GSM communication to be online to have some kind of reporting. And things like that can go up to actually large-scale wind parks, which are usually decentralized, so ever so many routers that you have are connected to a single cellular modem, and by that have an uplink so that they can be controlled, measured, and that the company running them can actually see what's going on. And yeah, with these devices becoming more and more, of course, it's interesting to work out how they work, see if there are any issues there, and actually, yeah, understand them. The other part that I actually am aiming at is kind of this the state-of-the-art thing. So usually when you work with technology, or if you give somebody hints on what to do, you know you go for the state-of-the-art. You tell them to use modern solutions to apply modern security, follow the state of the art. And here the question basically is, what's actually the state of the art for embedded communication, for M2M devices, and for next to everything that's actually hooked up to cellular networks, which isn't a mobile phone or a computer? As a quick outline, I've got a set of case studies here, which I'll be presenting, some a bit longer, some a little bit shorter. Going to give a little insight into, well, what all devices actually do very similarly, and where there really are very big differences, both in actually usage and in security. I'll do that, on these devices, and then at the end we'll have a few summaries, actually trying to show what we can change and what could be done. For the methodology, for me, the first point is the most important, reading manuals. I hate reading manuals. I actually don't really ever do it. But while I was looking for devices, that's actually the manual on the right. It's one of the first ones that I actually had a look at. And I don't know if you can read it. It basically says it's a home alarm system. And it says, send a text message with the content 0 to disable the alarm system. So just from thinking about it, can everybody send this message? Can only I send this message? How is the alarm system actually able to work out who I am? And if I'm really the one who's supposed to control it? So the manuals were really very helpful for, identifying potentially broken devices and actually choosing the first parts. The implications from the manuals, then I tested all the features, I did a very basic set of fuzzing already. So, you know, if you've got text messages that you can send, you've got a list of commands. What you do, you go and you send an empty text message, you send a text message with 160 characters, you put in some special characters, and, you know, just check if there are any really stupid mistakes in there. From there, yeah, I've summarized the results, which I'm going to present today, and I've had a look at a few potential measures that could be applied. For my setup, what I've got in front here, this silver box here is my cellular base station. It's a nano BTS. As explanation, for you who've been here before, Troopers has been running an own cellular network throughout the conference for a few years now. As such, we've got licenses to actually run our own network. My BTS is currently running on exactly that license. So right now, all the stuff that I've got on the table here is really using GSM communication to talk to my laptop. So that's basically the list of the components that I have. Looking at that, so this is my base station, which is the silver box, the base station controller and the MSC, and also, it's actually not up here, the home location register. So this is basically the database of all the devices that may connect to my network. That's good. These are the components work on the communications. And everything on the right side from here is currently virtualized on my laptop. So when looking at the bottom part, we've got the SGSN and the GGSN. So I've actually also got basic edge communication that I can actually also do IP communication with these devices. So I've got a few things like the device is actually opening something like a web server, which can be reached via the cellular network. And that's something that I can access this way. Lab feature-wise, I'm able to do phone calls. Basically, if necessary, I'm able to use a VoIP uplink to the, to the PSTN. As such, well, I can forward a call to an actual phone number. If necessary, I can use text messages, normal SMS, 160 characters, and send them around. And I've got basic IP connectivity. You know, using Edge and GPRS, it's dead slow. It's not, well, the perfect solution to go in for doing any port scanning, but it works. So, you know, a port scan might take 2 days, but, you know, you started Friday, you've got the results on Monday, that's okay. You can live with that. So for these things up to here, it's what I call a lab setup. So that's the stuff that I've got here. All the devices in here have SIM cards. The SIM cards in the devices are actually my own SIM cards. So we've got a company in China producing SIM cards. We configured them ourselves, and these SIM cards will only be able to connect to my network unless somebody else decides to let them in, but that usually doesn't happen. So this is, let's say, the devices wanting to connect to my network and being aimed at connecting to my network. The whole thing, of course, also works, well, slightly more malicious, which is using something like a fake base station, call it an IMSI catcher. The term Stingray has become famous over the past few months. So what I can do in theory is I can spoof a valid cellular network. It might, you know, at first glance, if you haven't done a lot with cellular communication, sound a little bit strange or, well, hard. But basically, you know, how does a Wi-Fi network work? A Wi-Fi network has a name, and you look for this name. And also, the access point has a MAC address that you can look at. And basically, a cellular network works exactly the same. You've got a mobile country code, which is the MCC, which for Germany is 262. And you've got a mobile network code, which, for example, for T-Mobile Germany is 01. And these are simply two, well, numeric values that are broadcasted by the base stations. In theory, right now, nothing is stopping me. Well, the law is stopping me from doing so. Technically, nothing is stopping me from actually configuring those values in my own base station, which would mean that especially if you go into the cellars here, where you've got next to no cellular reception, all your devices will connect to my base station. The nice thing about that is, where is it? So my network actually right at the moment is set up in such a way that devices aren't let in. So I've got a wide list of devices which may access my network. This here is my HLR. The 26287 are my own devices. And if you actually go down here, the 23 are Henrik's devices. He's currently giving a cellular hacking workshop upstairs. And I'll just go down quickly a little bit. You know, you've got various other IMSIs of devices, and I'll hide that again, of devices that actually are trying to connect to my network. Meaning, while you're sitting here and while you're roaming through the building, be sure that your normal mobile phone with a normal SIM card might at some point try to connect to my network or to our Troopers network that we're running. So it's currently us locking your phones out. It's not your phones not trying to connect to our network. So this lab setup very simply can also be used in a malicious approach to actually attack devices. The basic algorithm, I think it's a little bit hard, complicated to actually call it an algorithm, it's less than that. Your mobile phone will go in and will connect to its home network. And you know, your T-Mobile customer, Vodafone customer, you'll connect to that network. If this network isn't there, then it will go in and, well, basically simply connect to the strongest signal. So, you know, being an attacker, I always make sure to be the strongest signal. Going in maliciously, ignoring laws, you know, I can use a jammer to actually lock out all other valid networks. And your device will only be able to connect to my network because there won't be any other available. Speaking about GSM right now, quite a few people, well, kind of thought that it would be, you know, go for LTE. LTE is more secure than GSM. The problem is the devices are able to speak GSM. And there are quite a few documented attacks against LTE or even 3G networks where you send a magic text message, or a magic, not a text message, a magic message to the device, and you can actually kill LTE on the LTE phone. Meaning that until you restart the device won't be able to connect to LTE networks anymore. So, you know, I'm kind of locking your device out of secure networks so that you don't have any other chance but using insecure networks with all consequences coming from there. So I'll be talking a little bit more about that throughout the talk. But just keep in mind that even though what I've got here is a lab setup and my devices have my SIM cards and they want to connect to my network, all your devices can also be convinced to connect to my network. It might be a little bit of work, but it will work in the end. So from there, the very first one, as you can see, I've titled it What You Know. So basically, the next few slides or the next few chapters are oriented along kind of the authentication mechanism that's actually in use. So the first approach is what you know, you have a secret, you need to know something. For this, my first case study is a little tracker. As you can see, it's on the picture, or you could see it. Just shift this over here. So I've got a lot of window shifting right now because I've got all the devices here, which actually really is just this device. It's a, well, about 10 euro tracker. If you're unlucky and you actually buy it on Amazon, you pay something like 60 euro for it. If you buy it from some other websites, it'll really just be 10, 15 euros. It's got a micro USB on the side here. It's got an SOS button. You know, well, if you press it, then a stored number will be called and will be informed that you pressed this, the emergency button. And in the back, it's got a slot with a SIM card in it, which is good that I just removed it. So that's my first case study. So the basic approach here is that whenever you send a text message to the device, it will respond with its location. When I started using it, I thought, yeah, great, a small GPS tracker. Actually, turns out it's not quite GPS. It's close, but basic usage, you've got a command DW. So you can use a normal mobile phone and actually send a command or the command DW to the device, and the device will process this command and will send back a text message. So the content of this text message down here will be, new presenters, will be this please link and then GPS UI net. And as you can see, it's got a location area code, it's got a cell ID, it's got a mobile country code, which is the 262 for Germany, and it's got a 23, so that's actually one of my old test setups, and the lab network that Henrik is currently using upstairs. So it's actually just sending us the network ID and the cell ID that this device is currently connected to. So in theory, you can use this data, go to some web service. There are enough sites that have all the cell towers around the world mapped and will then actually give you location. For this one here, sadly, I wasn't quite as lucky. So when actually going onto the website, there we go. This actually is the website. I can see some, I guess it's Chinese characters telling me, well, service doesn't seem to work.
Very sorry, it's busy.
Very sorry, it's busy, okay. In that case, I can say it's been busy for about 2 weeks now. So, well, who knows? It's very, very busy. As I said, all that I do is I actually send in a text message. So, you know, what's the actual authentication factor or the shared secret? Well, it's the number of the SIM card in the device. That's the only authentication factor that there actually is. You know, mobile phone numbers are top secret and you can't guess them and you can't enumerate them in any way. So far this actually, you know, you get a location code and you can actually find the device, which already is, you know, quite a security issue. It actually gets worse. You've got this very beautiful voice callback feature. So actually, if I send a text message containing four ones in there, this little device here has two microphones in it. It will call me and I can hear everything that's on the other side. Meaning, of course, you know, I don't really know where the person is, but I can actually also hear what he's doing. Which, you know, makes hacking these devices simply quite a bit more fun. Also, there's a feature, if you read through the manual, which is called authorized numbers. For me, that actually sounded like, you know, a security feature. Numbers that are authorized to use the device. I've configured it multiple times. I've reset it multiple times just to make sure that I didn't do anything wrong. I hope I didn't. What the authorized numbers actually are is if I press the SOS button, then a call will be started calling these authorized numbers. So they're simply the emergency numbers that will be calling, that will be called. This authorization is absolutely no kind of security. So, you know, that's first case study. And not starting very nicely. Yes?
You said it's not actually GSM.
It's GSM, it's not GPS.
Ah, okay.
Sorry. Moving from there.
What better what the number is? I think the device can only call one number.
It can actually call three numbers, so it will try the first, then the second, then the third until it's reached something. So it is actually multiple numbers. Then we've got the next part, what you know advanced. So you know, I can't really configure this mobile phone number, so it's not really an individual secret that I decide on. So from there, you know, we are moving towards more secure approaches. My next case study is, well, a gate opener, a garage door opener, whatever you actually want to use it for. It's yet again hooked up to the GSM network. It receives text messages. It receives phone calls. I got this one from Amazon for about €40. I know that it actually is on the market available with something like 6-7 different brandings from different places. So it's yet again one of these magical Asian devices that are sourced somewhere and sold under very many different names. So usage is very simple. You send a text message to the device with a pin. And this pin up here is the 4-axis, and then you send a CC. So basically, let me see, got this over here. Going back to the camera. This here actually is just the device. And if I go and prepare a text message, let's see, just checking the database to hit the correct number, 0033 CC, so this actually is, well, not quite. Well, that's a bit. 0033 is the pin. Then I've got the CC, and the CC is simply the command to actually control the relay in the device. And if I send it, then it'll take a few seconds for the text message to run through my network and find its way to the device. And then in a second, did you see it actually go red? You hear a very slight click, which is the relay switching, and I can control the device. So, you know, that's just the, it's a bit too bright on air, the confirmation relay on, telling me it worked and everything's fine. So that's the way that I control it. So, you know, a 4-digit pin is at least a start. I played around with it a bit. The device then confirms the action. If I actually send a wrong PIN number, I get absolutely no response. Which, you know, it's hidden, it's nice, and it does what it's supposed to do. So I already went there for a second. You know, classical approach, 4-digit PINs are fun. Complexity of 10,000, so text message flat rates for the win. I go in and, you know, I send 10,000 text messages and then see what happens. To do this, you know, you don't want to do it by hand. You actually use a script for it. Let's see if it's got... Hope it's large enough that you can actually read the lines. So this script actually isn't very nice. It's just there for demonstration purposes. It's not very effective at all. It uses my cellular backend, uses a control terminal from there, which is the VTY, which I actually connect to via Telnet. And using exactly this line here, I send a text message to the subscriber with the number 9993, which is exactly my device that I've got here. The source number is the 0001, which is my normal phone. And I simply generate text messages and send all these text messages to the device. And you know, the way things go, it's just starting a script like this, and it's off sending text messages. It's, I think, a text message per second. PIN is 33, so in about, you know, half a minute, the device will yet again click and will actually change and switch. So first thing that we notice is, well, we don't really have any brute force protection. The device simply accepts thousands of text messages. Brute force protection is, of course, something that we would expect in every device that actually uses some kind of password or PIN. Sadly, this device simply hasn't got anything like that implemented. So going in this way is, you know, one very simple approach. You know, currently I'm trying to use the command to open the gate. That was the click, and it's unlocked. of course, you know, if you actually want to, that's the confirmation that it's open. If you want to go in a very little bit deeper, you know, you simply start attacking something like a pin change command, which is just as easy. I send the old pin, followed by a P, saying that I want to send a new pin, and then I very simply add the new pin. So yet again, going in with a maximum of 10,000 tries, I'll set a new pin on this device. This yet again, lab setup, but you know, real world scenarios, if you actually work out the phone number of the device, you can use whatever online APIs they are, like Twilio, et cetera, to generate the SIMs via the SMS via any kind of API that you want and have them sent out. And sending 10,000 text messages is cheap if you know what you're going for. So yet again, a very slight problem. This also in the slides, exactly the code that's necessary. Going for the 000P1234, simply sets it to a new pin being 1234. Also here, you know it's only a 4-digit pin, not more. It's brute forcible. There's no kind of protection. So, yeah, you know, kind of secure. Only security measure is this pin. Luckily, at least right now, we've got something like that. It doesn't respond to invalid commands. So at least it's quiet. That's a start, which will change in a bit. So another note here yet again, you can also here actually configure authorized phone numbers. The authorized phone numbers here is actually rather something like a money-saving approach. So if you've got a device with an authorized phone number, you can call the device. And simply due to the incoming call, it will react to the number and it will open the gate yet again. So very simple mechanism of working with. Configuration-wise, it is possible to set up the device that everybody can call it and trigger it. Yet again, you know, using or deactivating any kind of security measures is a bad idea, and people will be able to actually exploit it at some point. So then we're moving on to the next factor. We're getting to what you have, so actually something that the attacker has to have. For this, my next case study is the very beautiful Smarnos X300 home alarm system, which is, you know, the way that these devices work. You can control them via text message. You get them from basically all large German electronic stores, so they're actually out there on the market. Smarnos has quite a few of these devices in different brands and variations. Simple approach, arming, disarming notifications, everything via text message. So yet again, here to start, we have authorized phone numbers, which are one of the core measures. So I've got to send in a text message, send in a text message containing, I think, the digit 3, which is add authorized phone numbers. Then the device is so nice to actually respond with exactly this text message, so it'll say tell, and then the digits, and then all that I have to do is I have to forward this text message, edit it, and send it back. And then all numbers that I add are trusted by the device. And of course, it confirms the thing with store phone number successfully. Perfect English yet again. Usage, that's exactly where my manual slide came from, is you send a text message with a 1 or a 0, and, well, you arm or disarm it. Now, the interesting part here is, as I said here, configuration. Configuration means that the user has actively got to do something. If you unbox the device, you put a SIM card in, it will work. It will work as an alarm system. You can arm and disarm it via text message. The only thing that it won't be able to do is that if the alarm goes off, it won't be able to send a notification to your phone. But otherwise, it works. Meaning, everybody can control it, and everybody can send in a text message with the one or the zero to very simply arm or disarm the device, which yet again for a home alarm system isn't quite what we're aiming for. Sadly also right here, if I send a text message from an unauthorized phone that's not on the list, the device will respond. And it will tell me operation phone failed, phone number is not authorized. Which yet again, you know, coming from internet scanning, I could write a script sending millions of text messages through complete number spaces. And if some device or some number responds with this message, I know that it will have one of these alarm systems hooked up to it. So, you know, scanning via SMS, I think it hasn't really been done a lot. Probably most providers would actually mind and mind stop you from will stop you from doing so. But there again, you know, we're hackers, we've learned to be stealthy. So we will find ways of doing so. Meaning yet again, we've got a device that we can find, that we can identify, and that we can attack. Security here, yet again, is based on this authorized phone number. Meaning, if you've got my phone, you can control it via text message. Now, I talked about my IMSI catchers and my stingrays and, you know, turning my lab setup maliciously. Problem here is that, you know, you saw the list with all the devices that tried to connect to my network. And in this list, you've got one very nice column, which is the first column on the left, which is the extension or the phone number of the SIM card. So what quite a few people don't really realize, a SIM card does not have a phone number. A SIM card has an IMSI. It's a unique identifier for the SIM card in the device. The mobile network operator has a database, well, just like this. Well, it's bigger, it's more complex, it's got more data in it. But it's got a list just like this, having the IMSI here and having an extension for that. And that's the exact phone number of that device in my network. So whatever I put into this field here on the left, that's the number that the device that I'm calling will see. Meaning yet again that if I'm able to actually get one of these alarm systems into my network, and you know, whereas the phone number of the alarm system might be secret, kind of secret, you know, you bought the SIM card, you never told anybody the number. So it will be very hard to actually find it and to identify it. Your number isn't a secret. You know, basically everybody who's got your number, who's ever found you, knows your number. And you know, how realistic is it that if you've got an alarm system like that, that you've got two different phones, that you've got one phone with another secret number that you only use for controlling your alarm system, and you've got the other phone that you actually use to do your phone calls with? That's kind of slightly unrealistic. So yet again, if I've got your phone number, you know, I will just take this one here. I take this field, I go for a 00491511622, which is kind of the beginning of most ERNW phone numbers. I add the rest of the number, and basically I can spoof the phone number of exactly this device. And as such, if the victim, the alarm system is in my network, I can send valid messages from your numbers to this device. Yet again, security broken. You know, it takes a little bit of time, it takes some preparation to actually be able to get this device into my network and to attack it, but it's possible. And well, you know, let's say an alarm system in a normal flat, nobody would probably bother. But if you've got more complex alarm systems that can be controlled via text message in office spaces or whatever, well, you know, it might just be worth it to go that far and actually to attack the devices. The nice thing is the SmartNOS actually also has, oh, it's not even on here, sorry. It's got an app, and it can be controlled with a very simple app. And well, when I started using this app, I kind of tried to work out, you know, how does it actually work? I'm able to send text messages to the device. It will respond. So how is this device actually able to communicate with my app? And when having a close look at the app, you will very quickly notice, there it is, it already says GSM SMS. All that this app actually does is it sends text messages. It sends exactly the same text messages as I would type. You know, well, recycling the interface, it's usable, it works. Which of course that means, you know, just by using another magic app. Luckily, the device doesn't have a new attack vector, but also the control via the app is just as insecure as if you do it by hand from a text message. So, jump back here. As said, the very sad thing is it does actually respond with negative messages if the... it's not incorrect PIN. It's if the number wasn't authorized. So we can find them, we can scan for them, and we can start breaking and attacking them. Now, the next very nice chapter, classical IP communications. You know, being hackers, having done networking, everybody knows IP. And probably one of the most important or the hardest questions in IP is the communication that we're talking about going via a trusted network? And then the question, what actually is a trusted network? Do we need encryption? You know, it's this classical question. We remote control all our Ciscos via Telnet because, you know, nobody will ever get into this network, so we can use it. And, you know, even if you go in really deep and you do risk analysis, and you can actually say that nobody will really be able to access this network, in that situation, using Telnet can be valid. Because, you know, you don't have any risk because you don't have any potential attackers that can get in. But in real life, somebody can always get in. So this is one of my funnily favorite parts because kind of whatever I look at, it breaks while looking at it. It's a car GPS tracker. So it's basically aimed at placing it in your car and, you know, if your car moves, you can see where it goes, what it does. You can get them on the internet. I got mine yet again from Amazon, starting at about 50 euro. There are quite a few car part dealers out there who will sell these devices. The starts, well, you say with it, don't buy them. Don't even think about buying them. You know, if you think that tracking somebody can be bad, there are far worse things that can happen. I'm just saying, you know, there's an immobilizer feature. So configuration, you set up an APN. And the device will then simply hook up to the cellular network and will start doing IP communication. To actually tell it whom to talk to and, you know, where to send its current position, you've got this command down here, which is the admin IP. This IP address actually is just the IP address as it's in the original manual of the device. So it's nothing that I fished out anywhere. It's on all websites containing these trackers. And then the device will simply, well, communicate with raw TCP with this port 9000 on that IP address. The nice thing about this is I can set my own IP address. So basically, if I don't trust the web service of this vendor behind the device, I can set up my own system and have it communicate there and send its position there. Problem yet again is, you know, it doesn't do encryption. Now comes the very nice part. I had tweeted about this a while back and spoken to a friend who actually thought that the tweet was a joke. Sadly, it wasn't. It's this feature. You take your car, you cut the power line to the oil pump, and you've got on the device, I've got millions of meters of cable here. just to actually show it yet again. This is the GPS tracker. This is a relay, very simply switching relay. These are the two lines that I actually connect to the power supply of the oil pump in the car and put the relay in the middle. So, you know, I send a text message, I use the immobilizer feature and I kill the oil pump. I had a discussion with a friend of mine. We aren't really sure if the company actually meant oil pump. It could be that it was the fuel pump, that they were slightly confused. Whereas you've got to think about it. If you kill the power supply of the fuel pump, it will stop your car. If you kill the power supply of your oil pump and cooling breaks down and your car doesn't notice, it will kill your car. So it's kind of the fatal immobilizer. So this device yet again is very nice. You can do everything via text message, classical approach. You can track the vehicle via a website, kill the oil pump or the fuel pump if necessary, you know. Funnily enough, all GPS trackers, you know, remember that phrase that I found, all of them have a microphone in them. So yet again, also here, you know, you can actually call this GPS tracker and you can talk to the guy who actually just stole your car. It's also got a microphone. It's actually also got an emergency button that you can press, you know, if you're in distress, which yet again, it might make sense. You know, you never know. But you know, you're driving. An attacker knows where you are due to the GPS data. He can tune into the radio station that you're just listening to because he can hear the radio, and he can kill your fuel pump. Maybe not really the nicest scenario. Communication yet again, use of HTTP. It's, well, plain text in parts. Other parts are raw TCP. Guess there's not really a lot to say about it. The web service, not part of the talk, but it looks a very little bit strange. Notes, nightmares. That's kind of what I had when looking at these devices. So the really big challenge about these is, you know, I read on the internet and I had a look at quite a few pages. I luckily wasn't really able to find documentation of anybody ever actually using these devices. You know, it's one of these devices yet again that comes from China and vendors just sell them. And well, I'd be very happy if these devices would actually vanish from the market, but whoever's interested can come round after the talk and we can maybe talk about them a little bit more. There is quite a bit of fun going on with these devices. So that was IP communication. The whole thing then goes a little bit further. Things can actually get secure. So you've probably already seen it, that I've got my Siemens device here, which is a GSM interface for the Logo 8, which is basically a very simple PLC for home use and small office use, you know, for small automation purposes, etc. And basically what this device does is it offers SMS and IP control to, well, these small-scale SCADA devices. I can say I'm using three of the small-scale SCADA devices at home, and I'm very happy that they're locked away in VLANs and can't talk to anything else. You know, the classical SCADA issues that we all know about, it's unencrypted, it's insecure. So for me here, it yet again was very interesting to actually see how does the online part look like and how secure is that? Actually, I was rather surprised. So configuration here is you've got a proper web interface on the device. Said it's HTTP, but you know it's in your home network. That's something with at least a lower risk. And you can then actually add proper users. You can add their phone numbers. You can add email addresses, so it's got, well, it'll run to some web server and will fetch emails, and if you send a control email there, it'll switch, and it'll do whatever you want. Security-wise, what I was very surprised about, here you've actually got the option to set a proper password. So instead of going for this four-digit PIN, you can set an alphanumeric eight-character password, which is right up here. Yeah, top secret. There wasn't enough space for the T. Nice thing here, of course, at least is, you know, a little bit of, well, positive information. It's eight characters. Brute forcing eight alphanumeric characters via text message is rather exhaustive. And, you know, if an operator or the cellular operator doesn't notice, you know, hacking a four-digit PIN, he will probably kind of notice and be red flagged if you go after an eight-character password. Here yet again, you know, I did it in my lab setup. Breaking it is possible, but it's kind of rather a two-step approach. So what an attacker can do is, if you run one of these devices, he can go in and he can actually attack your phone. And he will intercept the data coming from your phone and can intercept one text message. And as such, very simply extract the password. And when he's got this password, he can go over to where the actual device is placed, grab that with his IMSI catcher, and then simply yet again control it. So also here, even though we've got proper password, it's still attackable if it's done via text message. I can say here about the Siemens device, actually it seems to be the most secure device that I've got on this table here. You know, it's things like you actually want to enable IP control. The only way that you can enable it is by using HTTPS. It's encrypted. You have the possibilities to upload your own certificates. So, you know, of course, the way it goes, it's got a vendor-supplied certificate with a crappy date on it, but you can actually configure it securely for the IP communication, which I was very, very surprised about. And this actually also was the only cellular embedded device that I've ever seen that actually forced me to set a complex password. So it actually has got proper password rules on it. So that's at least the start. Coming from IP communication, I've got a few more, well, devices on here that I thought were rather interesting. I've got a smart meter, which I bought from eBay. It's, as you can see, it doesn't really have a lot of wires on here. It's actually just a single-phase smart meter that, does typical metering. The nice thing is it came with a SIM card, still from the operator, that, well, I've got no idea. Seemingly the guy who had used it at home actually took it out and put it onto eBay. So there was still the original SIM card in it, luckily. Here again, you've got these famous APN, the access point name. So that's basically if a device dials in to use data communication as cellular network, he'll connect to some kind of host or service, which will be used as a gateway. And what they actually did is they've got an own APN, which means that IP communication will at least be separated in the backend networks. You know, it's my lab setup. I kind of ignore APN names. So whatever APN it wants to connect to, I'll just say, yeah, okay, come on. And it will connect to me. Funnily enough, I then had a look at the traffic using Wireshark. That's a simple approach. The device actually stayed quiet for something like 15 minutes. And I thought it might have been broken. And then at some point, it actually started talking UDP packets, which were sent to actually a web service belonging to the manufacturer of the device. And I set up the meter because, you know, all the messages looked the same. I actually got out an electric heater, hooked it up to the smart meter to actually burn some energy so that the meter would count something and it will go up. Sadly, I wasn't able to see any meter values. I've got no idea why. It's something that I'm still playing with. But every single text message that went to the backend contained the serial number on the device. So the serial number is printed on the device, and I can see this number in every single packet being sent towards the backend, which yet again doesn't really, you know, probably no encryption on there. So yet again, very nice and broken approach. The whole thing is set up in such a way that you've got the meter itself, which is on the right. Then you've got the GSM modem, which is on the left. You've got the SIM card slot down there. Okay. That's range. Yet again, the modem talks to the meter and then simply hooks it up to the magical cloud. One device that I sadly do not have a picture of. I've got a very nice suite control box for solar systems. You know, not big scale, but the stuff that actually, you know, private people have on the roofs. And it is running a Windows CE 6 and a bit. Can anybody guess what the problem might be? How would you control old Windows CE 6 devices? Telnet. I know from some of my own experience, you know, when using cellular communications, you know, you sometimes look what other devices are in the networks, and there already has been quite a lot of documented mass scanning of cellular network IP ranges. And it actually turns out that this Telnet port really, in some devices, is exposed publicly. You know, it's got a modem in there with its own SIM card, and it's there so that the company running the solar system on your roof can connect to it and can actually get metering values. And you know, if the company can, we can. I so far haven't really gone into cracking the password, but that's something that's on my list. I'd be very surprised if there'd be different passwords on all the boxes, you know, experience. Then I've got my Phoenix Contact SMS relay, which is a very simple 230-volt device that, you know, send in a text message, and it will switch lights or whatever you've got connected. Here, one of the interesting parts was, yet again, control via email. Nicely done. It does at least check the source email address. But, you know, I've got my IMSI catcher. I can let it connect to my own network. I can spoof IP addresses. I can spoof mail servers. If I can spoof mail servers, I can spoof source addresses. So, you know, coming from there, I can attack it. One further part that I actually don't have on the slide, because I haven't really gotten into it that deep yet, I've got one of these Verifone VX680, which is these small credit card terminals that usually a pizza delivery guy has on them, where you swipe your card, enter your PIN, which is also connected via cellular networks. The funny thing that I've got there is it's actually a strange glitch. So it will work with a normal SIM card on a normal mobile network. It will connect, it will work. If I try to force it into my own network, it won't work. So I'm currently trying to work out if that's actually a technical issue in my network or some kind of magical security feature. If it's magic, I know that I can probably break it. If it's a bug, I'll fix it, and that's something for, you know, future work. So, summaries, thoughts, ideas. It took me quite a long time to actually work out the content of these slides. Very simply because, you know, if you show that something's broken, you've got to show how to do it better. And that's simply part of how IT security and how our community works. But in some situations, it's just hard to say anything else then don't do it. And telling people not to do something is always very hard. This is especially the point for the text messages that we saw. Using these text messages for remote control relies on the fact that the cellular network is secure, which means that no attacker is able to spoof source telephone numbers, which can be done. It can be done via fake base stations. It can be done via various other telco network backend attacks that have been shown over the time. It's possible, and it will be possible for a long time, at least as long as GSM networks are there. Simply because with a GSM network, the network has the possibility to identify a subscriber and to lock a SIM card out. But the device itself simply isn't able to validate the authenticity of the network. So I'm always able to spoof a GSM network, and the device will connect to my network. So sadly, for text messages, it's kind of a recommendation. If you rely on it and if it's critical, don't use it. Controlling stuff via text message in modern networks doesn't work. It's kind of the same approach as using telnet via the internet, which we've learned might be a stupid idea. Device control via voice call is exactly the same problem. Above the fact that I'm not actually able to share a secret via these, dial-in, it rings and it unlocks. It's the same problems and the same vulnerabilities as when I go in and actually use text messages. For IP, it's the same problems that the IT security community has seen in any kind of IP network over the last 10, 15, 20 years. And very simply, it's always this argument, it's a secure network, nobody will ever able to go in. Or it's the question, why would anybody ever do so? People will. That's the way the world works. So, when using some kind of IP communication, also via cellular networks, we need to apply everything that we nowadays call security best practices. It's not a question of actually aiming at high security or, doing whatever magic there. It's just a question of, is communication encrypted? You're logging in somewhere, use authentication. And that's very simply something that on these embedded devices, it's hard to find. Not a lot of companies actually do it. Device control via app would, in theory, be a very good idea. So I spoke about it before. You've got passwords that you send via text message. A text message can, in theory, be used rather securely. Let's go in and say you do something like using asymmetric encryption for commands. If I put an asymmetrically encrypted command into a text message and send it somewhere else, the other party is able to validate this message. I've got these classical problems about replay attacks, etc. If I prevent those, everything's fine. The thing just is that text message control, from what I've seen so far, is mainly aimed at usability. You've got all these old phones, that don't have apps or whatever, and you want to enable everybody to be able to control your target device with a text message. So when using secure text messaging, you will need an app. Otherwise, unless anybody of you is actually able to do RSA in your head with commands and timestamps, I'd be highly impressed, but that's just not the way the world works. Then I spoke about the attacks via rogue base stations. Yet again, a very complicated topic. My personal impression is the risk from these attacks is rather low. You can expect it actually to rather be, let's say, a targeted attack. So if you've got a cellular alarm system in your house, somebody who actually wants to break into your house will do his homework. But then most probably it won't be a random burglar just going around because he won't have the equipment, he won't have the skill. So this is something targeted. And as always, you know, preventing and defending against targeted attacks is highly, highly complicated. Because, you know, the attacker has more time for attacking than you have for defending. For the mobile devices, it's really hard. You know, I spoke about the GPS tracker. And it's exactly the lines here, and I mean it just the way that I wrote it down here. You know, why should anybody set up a fake base station next to a motorway and hack every car that comes by? My personal impression, next to nobody would do so. The thing then just is, what if somebody actually does? You know, that would kind of be the end of the world for everybody on that motorway. And these attacks don't necessarily only work against dedicated embedded devices, but they might also work against components that are actually in vehicles or that are part of some bigger system. So, for me, what's next? I guess I'll be publishing quite a lot this year. I've got lots of to do on all these devices, you know, fuzzing, proper breaking, having detailed looks at everything that I have, and, you know, document what I found and, you know, try to actually do something better and help. I'll be giving a few trainings throughout this year, so if anybody's actually interested in learning how to do these attacks, seeing how to get an own setup up and running, feel free to drop me a message and we'll work something out. And yeah, you know, I'm always happy to share what I find. So as soon as I've got new results, they'll be on our blog and feel free to read and ask questions and participate however you want. So from there, thanks a lot for listening and have a nice evening. In that case, it would have to be Dominic. It's the only one in the first row.
Thanks for this great overview. What are your thoughts about using SSH as authentication procedure for the IoT stuff? Maybe as a user-friendly interface?
Yeah. In theory, it would be a good idea. But, you know, that's something for, you know, the future devices out there. Of course, we've had the experience in a few projects ourselves. How should I start? The main issue probably there will kind of be computational power and actually possibilities on the device that you want to control. You know, usually when one of these devices is developed, it's business making the decision to go for the cheapest chip. And the chip and the necessary price and computation power will be based upon the question, what's the functionality that the chip has to do? And it'll be as low power as possible. And then when security comes in, you know, it's not really able to do everything that's necessary anymore. So, you know, developing proper devices, having security in mind, good idea, perfect, that would be a good solution. But for now, in the way that most of these devices are developed nowadays, it'll take a while before we actually see anything like that in practical use.
Thanks.
Welcome.
Hi, Brian. Thanks for sharing your findings. You showed the smart meter. Mm-hmm. Can you say something about for which country it was deployed? Is it for German market?
This actually is one from the UK market, and this specific one actually came in from Cyprus.
Okay. You know anything? I think for German market, there's some hard requirements from BSI.
Yeah, there are hard requirements now for the new smart meters. But also there, as far as I can remember, you know, it's the way that BSI requirements are. They're good, they're a very good start, but, you know, they aren't really necessarily what we're actually expecting. But from what I've heard so far, you've probably seen the CCC presentations about the first smart meters that hit the market, which probably are the reason why the BSI had to put out security baselines with which have to be applied. I guess as soon as they're actually out there and added to the devices, then it should be fine. So.
There are lots of rumors or whatever that embedded devices, chipsets, and so on connect to unknown websites, do other stuff than the stuff foreseen. Have you ever noticed anything like that?
Yes. So one of my devices, which is also a GPS tracker, actually connects to a MuBlox web service. MuBlox is a company that actually makes cellular modems and GPS devices, or the chips, and system on chips with GPS. And of course, the one thought behind that is, of course, you know, tracking and bugging actually people. That's a problem that we have with every kind of, you know, mobile app nowadays. Most apps track you. But in that specific point, I actually think that the company who used the system on chip didn't remove all the parts of the actual firmware that the manufacturer put on there. So it actually looks like, you know, there's a very first boot state where the device comes up, and it then actually contacts home. So instead of rewriting the complete firmware, there still seems to be something left behind. Maybe as comparison, some Wi-Fi routers are actually attacked via backdoors based on the bootloader that's actually on the chip because they've got some kind of open telnet interface for recovering the device. And these interfaces and the software parts very often don't come from the actual vendor, the final device manufacturer. They are there from the chip manufacturer. So if you know devices aren't properly wiped and you don't start from zero, then you will find a lot of that stuff.
But that could be just carelessness by the
it manufacturer. Could. Yeah.
So you haven't had any evidence of actual malicious
channels? Not from the devices that I've seen.
Thanks.
More questions? If not, thanks, Brian.
Thanks.